Today we'll discuss briefly the isolation technology. So what are the isolation generally, why it is required, then very few things we'll discuss here. So I think separately I'll take another class about this isolation plus the evolution of the MOS technology. How it is shrink down from 0.5 micron to now is 500 nanometer. What are the isolation technologies are used? What are different features are used? So that thing, it's too long actually. That thing I'll discuss in separate, either in a extra class or I'll see how I'll cover that, because that is also give a very detailed insight to you. And second thing, the MOS, CMOS annual process. And then the layout related things, means layout rules and full custom layout, this thing we'll discuss at the end of this lecture. Okay. So this is the device isolation technology. So generally device isolation is very, very important in the fabrication process, because in a one plane, suppose similar type of devices are there. So in one plane, we are doing all the same type of devices, fabrication of the same type of devices at a time. So if the sufficient distance will be not there, or sufficient isolation methods will be not there, then there are many problems will be happen. One is leakage current between these two active devices. Okay, if there is a path, then leakage current will be flow. That will means increase your power consumption. Okay, that is main disadvantage point. Second thing is unwanted conduction path, that what I said, because if you suppose you don't want any conduction path between two devices, if there is due to some conduction path, current will flow, that again will power consumption. And to unwanted channels also. Okay, actually we want channel only, either one NMOS or PMOS, like that, but between the devices, separate devices, if there is a channel formation, again unwanted current will flow. Okay, so these are the things we have to remember. So that's why isolation methods are there. So lot of isolation methods are there to take care of these things. But here we'll study two isolation methods. One is east field oxide isolation technique, and another is locus. Okay, locus means local oxide of silicon. Okay, so in east field oxide isolation, here means after the means the silicon, over the silicon surface, the whole silicon surface covered by the thick field oxide, then we selectively etch. Okay, etch the oxide, and it's actually surrounded by the active region only. Okay, you will etch all other parts, only it will be in the it is surrounded by the active region only. So in this process, what happen, it is a very straightforward process, it is easy also, but the problem is during the subsequent layers, means polysilicon, then oxide, then the boundaries of the active region, means left side or right side. Okay, some the height differences is there, so due to that there is some chance of cracking of layers, means either metal layers or polysilicon layers. So due to these things, sometimes this is avoided. Okay, this type of isolation technique is avoided. Okay, this east field oxide isolation. Actually, this part we have yesterday we have covered, means how the oxide layer is covered the silicon, then we create a means active region by etching this oxide, then you create thin oxide, then polysilicon, over that we will create another oxide, then we will etch the oxide, then we will put the diffusion layers, then metallization. Okay, so during this process, so if you see that previous figure in your last PPT, so the left side of the active region and the polysilicon side, okay, there is a huge difference in the height. Okay, due to that, some cracking may happen. So that's why this is avoided. And the next thing is, what is the next? This is the local oxidation of silicon. This is also very popular. So in this process, what we'll do? We'll not selectively etch. Okay. We will selectively grow the oxide layer over the that silicon surface or surrounding the active region. Okay. In the previous process, we are selectively etching the oxide, but here the exactly opposite. We are selectively growing the oxide layer to create the isolation. Okay. So this process is somewhat difficult, but it is better than that etched field oxide isolation. Okay, so here the process is initially you can see in the figure A. We go some pad oxide over that silicon nitride. Okay, so this part we want underneath of that silicon nitride or that pad oxide will create the active region. So that's why initially we cover this through that pad oxide and silicon nitride. Okay, so. And the rest part, where is the silicon is exposed, we will put the field oxide. Okay. So after that, what we will do, we will create a P layer. Okay. Then inside that P layer, we will do the thermal oxidation process. Then the P layer will consume that oxide. Then it will create a, in that P layer and over this silicon nitride, everywhere the field oxide will be grown. Okay, so after that, what we will do? We will etch the field oxide over the silicon nitroxide, and yes, over the silicon nitride. Okay, and but the problem is once you will do the thermal oxidation process, the oxide will enter under the silicon nitride. Okay, so what is the problem is here, though oxide will enter below the silicon nitride, the final active region will be less. Okay, because in the left side and the right side, some region will cover by the oxide. So that's why the overall active region length is less. Okay, so this is one the problem. So generally it is called Bard's beak, means it's looking like a Bard's beak. So that's why generally the Bard's beak problem is there in locus process. So to avoid this, other shallow trench isolations also there and other isolation processes are there. But we'll discuss later that part in more detail. But this is the problem of the locus process. But it is very popular, but the only problem is the active region will be very, very small. Because if you go to lower channel length, this Bard beak will be not scaling, it will be constant. So that's why the major portion of the active region will be covered by the Bard beak. So that's why we will not prefer this process, this isolation process. We will go for the silicon trench isolation. So in that case, what happened, a trench is created, and inside that trench, your silicon will be filled. So that will create a better isolation. Okay, that thing we'll discuss in later. Okay, so this is the all about the device isolation. So you'll go and study this in more detail. So now, yesterday we stopped here the simplified NOL process.
Sir?
Yes.
Sir, when I was reading the Kang, there was a sentence was written that it limits the scaling and the device density. Sir, how it reduces the device density?
No, but that scaling part I'm saying, when you will do the scaling down, so you'll go for lower technology. Okay, what happened? The active area means that channel length will be less. Okay, suppose you will go from, for example, 65 to 45. Okay, 45 or 30, 35. the channel length will be less, but the bad big portion, okay, the means the encroachment of that oxide under the underneath of that silicon nitride, that will be not scaled as the channel is scaled. Okay, so that part is constant. So that's why the overall channel length, that means the active region, will be comparatively very very small. Okay, for if it is 90 nanometer, compared to 90 nanometer, in 30 nanometer, the encroachment is constant. Okay, that is not scaling. That's why overall active region or channel length in lower technology generally reduces. So that's why it limits the scaling limits, you said. And you said that density. What is yes, another? Exactly.
So device density.
Can you say again that sentence? It limits
the device. That limits scaling and device density. Bird speak.
Device density, I'll think about it. Device density, but the scaling part is this. Means once you go lower and lower, that encroachment is not scaled. That is constant. So that's why it will take major portion of that active region. Okay. So that's why it is in lower technology. It's very very difficult. And it will be a real disadvantage part. Okay. So density part I'll check actually. I'll check and let you know. So actually, I have planned this part, this isolation part, and the MOS technology evolutions. Means why? What are the different isolation methods are used in lower technologies? So I'll cover that in a separate section. Okay, separate lecture. Okay. So in that, I think we will discuss in more detail. So this is the annual process steps, simplified annual process steps. So first here, the right side is the total, means final cross-sectional view of the chip. Means this chip is nothing but a single NMOS and a single PMOS. Okay, and all the layers are there. Okay, so here the steps are, first you will create a NOL region and a channel sub-region. Okay, so here, so this is your silicon substrate. Okay, so you have these things. So after that, what you will do, you will do a channel NOL creation. Okay, then after that you will put the channel stops. Okay, channel stops in the oxide regions. Okay, these are the channel stops. Okay, so next what you will do, you will grow field oxide and gate oxide. So then you will fill the field oxide. These are the field oxide all over this structure. Then you will pattern, you will etch that part. Okay, then you will put the thin oxide, this part. Okay, so after that deposition pattern polysilicon. So after the thin oxide, you will put the polysilicon here. Okay, here polysilicon. Okay, so once you will put the polysilicon, again you will pattern that. So after, next is the implant source and drain. Okay, so you will means pattern this oxide part. Okay, this oxide part. Then you will diffuse the N plus here, P plus again for body, it's N plus. Okay, you will diffuse your ion implantation. You will create source drain like this. Okay, so also you will create the ohmic contacts between this source drain. Okay, for metal connections, substrate contact also. And then create contacts window. So after that, you will create contacts window, then you will deposit the metals. Okay, you will create a contact window here. This is the contact window. Then finally, you will put the metals. Okay. So yesterday, actually, I think Satabdi asked the why about that polysilicon contact is not there. Is it Satabdi or Pracheta?
Sir, I was asking about.
Okay, that. Actually, that polysilicon in device fabrication, actually there is no contact between metal and polysilicon is there. Actually, the polysilicon is connected to the metal outside of the chip. Okay, so in a device, there is no contact between polysilicon and metal. Okay, so whatever when you will do the design or you will do the layout, so you will extend the polysilicon from that polysilicon part, and outside the chip you will contact a metal, and means you will put a metal over that and place a contact. So that is the actual process. That's why for polysilicon there is no patterning and there is no contact window. Okay, but that source drain and body part, there is patterning and contact window is there, and metallization is there. Okay, for polysilicon there nothing, this type of process is not there. So we'll always extend the poly and we'll contact outside of the chip. So that's why this part you will not see any metal or any contact windows. Okay, so this is the simplified process steps. So now we'll go one by one. So this is the first step. So first step here, you can see the upper part. This is the like layout, and this is the exact 3D device of this part. Okay, so here you can see this gray region, that shaded region. This is the active part. Okay, active region of the NMOS and active region of the PMOS. So initially, what we will do? Initially, we will create the active regions. Okay. Initial the N-well region, after that a thick field oxide grown on the transistor. Okay, this active region created, then surrounding that active region, this field oxide will be grown. Okay, so this is the cross section view. We can think it is means it's sliced in center. Okay, this is overall device. So transistor surround the surroundings. Okay, it's a field oxide surrounded by the active regions. Then thin gate. Okay, this part is the thin gate. Okay, thin gate oxide grown on top of the active region. Okay, so these three things will done in this section. First is N-well deposit creation, then active region creation, then thin oxide deposition. Okay, so in the next part, you will see this part. This is the shaded region, that is the poly. Okay, polysilicon deposition. So poly layer deposition using CVD, chemical vapor deposition process is there. So in this process, the polysilicon will be selectively grown over the active region. This is the for that is special mask is used. For selective grown of the polysilicon on the active region. Okay. Then polylayer patterning by plasma etching. You have to know what is plasma etching. So that thing you can get or you will study that what is the plasma etching. Okay. Next thing is the CMOS N-well process. In this section, we will create the implantation of N plus and P plus diffusion layers. Okay, so in this active region, here NMOS, here PMOS, so you will implant the source and drain. This is N plus. Okay, the doping concentration is more than the general concentration. Okay, that's why it's N plus. Okay, so this is N plus diffusion again in the N, inside the N well it's a P plus diffusion. Okay, in body parts in the N well you can see the N plus again. This is substrate contact for PMOS. Okay, this is also NMOS. Okay, and for this NMOS, this whole body is nothing but substrate contact for NMOS. Okay, so then you will create the ohmic contact also for metal connection. Okay, so next part is here you will create the will pattern that region. Okay, you will grow oxide, then will pattern. Okay, this is done N plus, then will over that surface will grow oxide. This is the oxide. Okay, this whole part is oxide. Then we will create the contact windows by patterning that oxide, okay, so that we can contact N plus diffusion to the metal. Okay, so contact window creation. And 1 minute. So the final slide, where is the final slide? Okay, I forgot to insert the final slide. So finally, you will get this type of means final. This is the layout of the, and a cross section view of that chip. Instead, the NMOS and PMOS both are there. So finally, you will do the metallization. Means you will put the metal. Okay. And this metal will go outside for source or drain and connections. Okay, so this is the all over the steps, means all the steps needed to create a CMOS, means with a NMOS and with a PMOS, we'll create a CMOS by using these steps. Okay. So these are the summary of the steps. What are the steps generally used for this fabrication? So initially oxidation the first step. So formation of silicon dioxide layer on the surface of the silicon wafer. Okay, that is the oxidation, either it's field oxide or thin oxide. Okay, so dry oxidation is there, wet oxidation is there, two methods are there. Okay, so dry oxidation is lower rate but highest quality, but wet oxidation is rate is more, means you can in a smaller time you can create an oxidation layer, okay, very less time, but the quality is not good. Okay, so then formation of thin film of surface of film is either it's a semiconductor, insulator or metal, so anything you can put the surface of the silicon. Okay, so chemical vapor deposition process is used here. So a lot of APCVD, LPCVD, PECVD, all the chemical vapor deposition processes are there. So you can read from net or you can know this thing in better way. Okay, next, implantation diffusion for source and drain creations. You will do the implantation or diffusion process. Okay, so to create that source region and drain region. Okay, N plus or P plus. Okay. So next, etching is every time you create a pattern, you create a layer, you have to etch. So that is important. So removal of the specific material layers on the silicon substrate are classified as dry and wet etch. So different etching methods are there. Okay. So dry etch or plasma etch or wet etch, like that. And finally, this photolithography process, every time you will do the photolithography, means once you will, suppose for oxidation, you will create oxide layer, then you will pattern that, and that is you will use the photolithography. So for metal layer, you will do the lithography. For polysilicon, you will do the lithography. So this part will be repeated process for every layer. Okay. And the isolation also part of this thing, means you have to put oxide layers in between the active devices. Okay, so either it's a field, each field oxide isolation or locus or STI, whatever be the. So these are the means general steps to do a fabrication of a chip. Okay, so this is mostly, these are the theoretical things. So you can go through the book or any good materials, or you can search in more detail for a particular, if you want to know what is CVD, what is plasma, what is the wet oxidation or dry oxidation or wet etch or dry etch. So you can selectively read that part from any good materials. Okay. So,
sir, that etching and photolithography, sir, etching, in that we're removing the oxide or the
polysilicon. Yes, yes, etching. Yes, so what is the difference we are seeing?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Difference is this is almost same, but different etching is used. sometimes photolithography means this is the lithography means you create a pattern actually. Etching means you have to etch that, means you remove that part. Okay.
That means by the process of photolithography, we are doing etching, no?
No, photolithography. No, etching actually removing the particular object means particular layer. Okay. But photolithography means that all the mask process means you will create a photo, means you will select a mask and then you will put the UV lights. Okay, then you will then what you will do, you will create some insoluble, means that photoresist material, insoluble material to soluble material. So that process is actually photolithography. Okay, that's complete patterning process is nothing but the photolithography. Okay, so etching is completely separate, means to remove these layers, means whether it's oxide or whatever the layers, that is called etching. Okay, but that complete process means that UV lights, then photo mask, and then insoluble to soluble, that photoresist material. So this complete part is called photolithography.
Okay. So in a particular fabrication process, we can either use etching or photolithography, no? Like according to the need. Etching we're doing with some other chemical or something, CVD or so.
Sir, we can say etching is a process, is a part of photolithography.
Photolithography, yes,
sir. Is the end step actually? Yes, it is the final step of that photolithography actually. Because for etching or that photolithography process, different type of methods we can use actually. Suppose e-beam photolithography or means different type of photolithography also there. So we'll go through that. The e-beam and currently the electron beam photolithography is used. So complete that patterning, etching, everything is that coming under the photolithography. But that etching is the part of that photo, but it's the end point, means final step of that photo. Okay.
Yes, yes.
Sir, optical lithography is different from photolithography.
Optical?
Optical photolithography. Is optical lithography?
Optical lithography. All are the photolithography, but depends upon that the way using for photolithography. Suppose for 250 nanometer, it is using around 190 nanometer for wavelength, that light. Okay, now if lower technology, suppose for 22 nanometer, it is the beam wavelength is around 10 or 11 nanometer. So these are the different methods for photolithography. Actually, exactly, I'm not getting your question.
Sir, I was asking because optical lithography was mentioned there, so I was asking that what is the
difference? Sir, it is same. I checked internet.
Okay.
But it is also called optical lithography or UV lithography. That photolithography.
Actually, that part in a separate class we'll discuss, because the evolution of the CMOS technology, all this from suppose 0.5 micron to 0.5, so different lithography also, different lithography used, different device isolation methods will use. So that part we'll cover actually. So I'll go through that detail. Okay, so that part then we'll discuss. Okay.
Okay, sir.
So got the point that what is the photolithography and what is the etching? So photolithography is the complete process. It's the mask, then photoresist, then UV light and everything. Etching is the last process to remove that means a particular material. Okay. And next, actually, I have used some. Just I'm using some different slides. Just wait. Okay, so this is the correct slide actually. So this is the correct slide actually. Okay, so now that fabrication part is completed, so please go through that in detail. And lot of actually this is fabrication part is very means it's a vast subject actually. So it means all the parts, means etching, whether it's a photolithography, whether it is means deposition, ion implantation, or that different type of etching, different type of oxidation. It's a completely vast chapter. So I'm not expert in that part, but so you can study, or I will suggest some materials if you want to know details. So I'll give some materials, good materials, or I'll suggest to go some video lectures or some books. Okay, so now we'll discuss that layout design rules. Okay, in layout, so generally a lot of design rules are there in the layout. Generally, the vendor, fabrication vendor, provides this layout rules. So these are nothing but the geometrical. It's a geometrical constraints, spacing between the metals, or spacing between the active regions, and minimum width, okay, maximum width. All these things are in the design rules. Okay, so some minimum rules are there, some recommendations are there, some guidelines are there. So all are there in a document, or means it's, you have to obey. So for a circuit designer, you have to obey all these design rules so that you can do a good design. And that's why in the verification tool, generally you will check the design, DRC, that is called a DRC, design rule check. So after doing the layout of any circuit, you will go through that process. We'll check whether what the circuit I have designed or layout designed, that is pass the design rule or not. So if it will not pass, then the fabrication vendor will not fabricate your chip. So you have to anyhow pass that process. Okay, so these are nothing but these things. So metal, polysilicon, interconnects means what is the via size, what is the minimum width of or dimension of that via. Okay, what is the minimum width of the metal. Okay, so you have to follow that, otherwise it will not follow, then finally it will not pass. But if they will agree to fabricate your chip, still the problem will be there. Means after the fabrication, if the width will be less, then it will not bear the current density. That means sometimes it may break. Okay, it may open. Or if you will put the width of the metal more than that minimum, then there is a chance of shorting with means neighboring material, okay, neighboring metal. So these are the rules means you have to follow. And minimum allowable separation between also, okay, separation between two features means either poly to poly, or metal to metal, or NOL to NOL, or metal to poly, or contact to contact. So lot of spacing rules are there, okay. And minimum feature dimensions, okay, minimum transistor dimension, you cannot go below that minimum width. Generally we are saying the minimum width, so means this is the minimum width, you cannot go beyond that minimum width. Okay, and minimum poly length. Suppose for a 180 nanometer technology, the minimum poly width, poly length is 180 nanometer. So you can't draw 160 or 150. So these are the minimum rules you have to follow for a layout design. Okay. So when you do the layout, you will clear about this. What are the other rules? Okay, lot of rules are there. Okay. So if you go lower and lower technology, generally the rules are added. Okay, if you suppose you, in 65 nanometer, you will get 1000 rules, but in 22 nanometer, it's lakhs of rules. Okay, rules are there, lot of rules in lower technology. Okay. And next thing is, generally these rules comes two way. Okay, generally they are defined in two way. One is micron rule, another is lambda rule. Okay, so in micron rule, means that all the numbers are in absolute. Okay, in micron, suppose metal to metal minimum spacing is suppose 10 nanometer, or minimum width of the metal is 20 nanometer. This is all are in absolute values. Okay, but in lambda rule, they are using a common parameter like lambda. Okay. According to that, they are saying this is 1 lambda. Suppose the poly width is 1 lambda, the metal width is 2 lambda, or some spacing between means metal and poly is 3 lambda, like that. So they are generalized the lambda length. Okay. So for every case, they will use a single parameter lambda. Okay. So this is the lambda rule and this is the micron rule. Okay. So this is the example. Generally, in the right side, you can see the figure. So, and in the left side, all the things are there, active area rules, then polysilicon rules, metal rules, contact rules. Okay. So all you can see in the active area, minimum active area width is 3 lambda. Okay. Here lambda is the parameter. Okay. And it is the 3 times of that lambda. Minimum active area spacing, meaning active area to active area spacing is 3 lambda. Similarly, polysilicon rules, width, spacing, and then extension over the active region, okay, and poly active edge spacing, okay. These are the related to poly, all the dimensions or the rules are there. So you have to follow and you have to do the layout. And metal rules also, minimum metal width and metal to metal spacing, okay. And contact rules, so minimum dimensions means length and width. The dimensions of the contact, okay, and minimum poly contact spacing, contact to contact spacing, poly to contact spacing, okay, metal contact to metal contact spacing. These are the contact rules. Okay. So these all, this is very means is a common rules, but actually in your design you will get thousands of rules. Okay, so for every, because you have say 7 to 8 layers. Means NOL, then P diffusion, then metal, polysilicon, oxide, contacts. So if you combine all these things, you will get lot of rules. So these rules you have to follow and you have to do the layout and you will pass through the tool. And this is the mask layout production process, okay, process flow. So how will finally you will means do a layout, and finally for that layout mask will be created. Okay, this is the initial process. As you know, the functionality and performance specification, then circuit, according to that specification will create circuit. Then from that circuit will estimate the parasitics. Suppose this is the circuit, this node, some fan out is there. Suppose one inverter is there, after the, at the output of the inverter, suppose you are connecting 4 inverters. So you will predict what will be the parasitics, means what is the parasitics at that node. Suppose you are in the input of the inverter, you are connecting some circuits. So what is the transition, means the slope of this input. So this thing you will means predict at the circuit level also. Then you will create the initial sizing of the transistor. So based on that, you will create the initial sizing, because here in the digital circuit, you will only need the functionality. And suppose 1 and 0. Okay, so for this case it's 1 and 0. So you'll always try to do the minimum sizing. Okay, so for minimum sizing we are getting the functionality or not. Okay, this is the thing. Next thing is you will create the stick diagram and layout. Stick diagram means in pen and paper you will draw some stick diagrams, how you will connect. Suppose some stack of the transistors are there. Okay, so more than means it's not like inverter. Suppose deep flip flop is there, or MOX is there, or multiplexer is there. Lot of transistors are there. So how you will connect that? Okay, so lot of interconnections. You will first you will draw a stick diagram in pen and paper. You will do the stick diagram. You will interconnect them means one to another. Then you will do the layout. Okay, then mask layout design means layout design. You will do through some tool. Okay, suppose layout design tool is there. Okay, so you will use any layout editor. Okay, you will create, you will design a layout of the transistor or the metal or connections. Everything will do. Okay, so after that you will do the design rule check. So once you will complete the layout or in between the layout, so you can check the design rule, because you can't means by seeing the layout you can't say that it is passed the DRC rule. So you have to check, because always you will not measure the distance between two metals or minimum width. So you have to check. So that's why you will use the tool. Okay, so for suppose you will do in the cadence series, PBS, in Mentor, Caliber, some tools are there. So you will pass this this part through the tool. Okay, once you will clear the means DRC rule, so then obviously you will do the LVS. LVS means schematic versus layout. Okay, that part is okay. It's not difficult, but DRC is important. You have, so once this thing that verification thing completed, then you will do the parasitic extraction of that layout. Okay, in circuit level you have estimated the parasitics, but here you will get the real parasitics. What are the parasitics with this means layouts, non-identities, means all the metals, all the poly, on the physical devices, how you will get the parasitics, how much parasitics you will get here. Okay, so after that again you will add the parasitics with the original circuit. Okay, with the original circuit means all the transistors, all the connections, and you will add the all the parasitics with that nodes. Okay, and you will check the circuit performance, whether it is matching what you have estimated in the circuit level or not. So one, if it is matching, then okay, otherwise you will resize and modify the circuits. You will again pass the DRC, again extract the parasitics, again you will do the layer means simulation. So this process will be iterative process. So once it will be completed, then its layout complete, then you will send for fabrication. There or they will create the mask for all layers, whether it's silicon layer, it's NVL or oxide. They will create all the masks and they will fabricate. So this is the mask layout production process. So in this way, finally, a mass of a layout will be created. Okay, and this is the full custom design of a CMOS inverter layout. Okay, so how we'll do a inverter layout? It's a very basic layout. So see the middle part. This is the polysilicon. Okay, so this part is your polys. Yes. So this part is your polysilicon. Okay, so you can see that minimum polysilicon. This is the okay. This is the actually it should be length. Okay, so this is the polysilicon length. This should be not more than the specified length, and this part is the source, or this part is for drain. Okay, so this is the active regions. Okay, minimum length of the active region. This is the total active region. Okay, and minimum separation in between this contact. So this is a contact. This contact means that active region to metal, because it will finally it will go outside. So this poly to metal contact, so separation will be there. Okay, Similarly, for contact to edge, the active edge, contact to active edge, and the dimension of the contact. Okay, this is the active and active width, active length and active width. Okay, so these are the things, the rules you have to check, and you have to pass this through the tool. Okay, so finally, this is the inverter layout. Okay, this is the PMOS, and the, you know, PMOS is covered by the N-well. Okay, so first you will create the N-well, inside that you will create the active region, then you will create the poly, then you will the contacts, and this is the rules and the NMOS here. So finally, in the inverter, for inverter, two transistors are there, gate are connected, and the drains of the both drains are connected. It is going to the output. And the source of PMOS is connected to VDD, and gate of the PMOS also, source of the NMOS connected to ground. So these things are the nothing but the metallization process. You will contact the metal. Okay. And here you can see the NOL VDD contact. Okay. So NOL to metal, there is some contact, because your NOL always, it is connected to the source and the highest potential. Okay, that's why NOL is contacted to the metal and it is VDD. Similarly, the ground also, here it is not shown, but the ground also connected to your P substrate. Okay, this is the active region, the source of the NMOS, but this ground will be connected to the P substrate. Okay, so though throughout the surface is P substrate, so anywhere you can contact connectors, but you have to pass from latch of rules also there. So for that you have to give the contact nearer to that active region. Okay, so this is all about that full custom max means layout. Okay, so in this lecture we have studied what is the fabrication of the NOL process, and what are the design rules, and how to how to design a create a mask layout. Okay, and how to design a layout of transistor or a simple inverter. Okay, so this is all about the lecture. So I'll say this is completed your second chapter. So now you can start reading that first chapter and second chapter, plus you have to do some backside problems. Okay, so this is related to the layout rules, related to that fabrication process. Some problems are there. If you'll do that, then your concept will be clear. Okay. So we'll stop here. If you want any question, then you can ask. About this layout rules or hello.
Yes, sir.
So, anything you want to ask about this layout, DRC, or custom layout, or mass generation? Okay, so we'll stop here. So at 1:30, we have a lab class. So in that lab class, if you have already installed, that is okay. Otherwise, Prachet and Satabdi will show you how to install that virtual box and that LXLE Linux. Okay. And also you have those who have installed, so we'll show how to clone the all the repository from the JIT to your system, and how you will work on that repository, then how to update or that repository. So we'll put some materials, then regularly you have to update that. So these things both Prachit and Saptad will show you. And after that, we'll do a simple RC circuit. Okay, the transient response of the RC circuit, that step response. Okay. So thank you all, and please go through that fabrication things in more detail. So actually, I'm not confident about that part. So I'll also in later, if you'll do, we can do another session about that fabrication part. So we'll go detail. Okay.
Okay, sir.
Okay. Thank you.
Hello.
Yes.
Sir, some are having doubt regarding that project and seminar project. That Shushri and Swamya Khadakra.
Yes, sir. Sir, hello.
Hello.